بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، the world is a mute deception for those who cannot see. It is silent, it is visible, yet it is in front of one. A person needs to be weary and cognizant of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us in this world for an objective. There may be many trials and tribulations and deceptions which may deceive one from the actual objective. Al-insanu abdul ihsan, whoever bestows bounties upon you, you become their slave. They are eligible to be served. If we look at mankind helping people, somebody has helped one in one's life, in a time of need, in a time of desperation, how much do we show gratitude to that person? وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us favorable bounties and ni'mas which cannot be enumerated. One needs to appreciate all these ni'mas of dunya and ni'mas of akhirat. And we should not make these ni'mas which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored us with as our objective and our purpose of life. If we see animals, their necessities are limited. Take for example a lion. A lion is fed fresh food. If a lion decides, okay, the animals I'm gonna hunt, I'm gonna start storing them, so I need a fridge, I need a freezer, I need a pantry, I need storage, I need long life shelf items to store this. How work intensive is that? If he decides I need a house, a residence, how much work will go in securing that house, how big the house is, then clothing. Animals suffice without any clothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made them such with their natural clothing, and they survive the harsh environments. Then if you look at it during illness, sickness, do they go to any doctor, surgery, operations, or that system runs on its own? So man, when world, the dunya becomes his objective, then first he becomes a slave of his needs, and eventually he becomes a slave of his greed. First he becomes a slave of his need, and then a slave of his greed. Malik Yasna used to say, the closer a person gets to sunnah, the more he will have sanctity. For example, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was not particular about his sleeping, his mattress, his comfort. If it was full double, he told them, no, leave it normal. I do not want to be distracted from my Allah. So Nabi alayhi salam, with regards to his sleeping habits, was not very particular about comfort. So looking at the example of Malik Ibn Ali, if a person is not particular, then they can sleep anywhere in the world. Now wherever they go, the bed is not right, it's too hard, it's too soft, it's too hot, it's too cold, it's too bumpy, the pillow is too this, too that. They become a slave to their habit, their need, and eventually greed when we attach ourselves too much to dunya. A believer is motivated by akhirat, and the taqaza and the demand of deen on any call, his labbaik is there. And that's the amal of Hajj is teaching us. When you say labbaik, Ya Allah, on every command I am present, I am ready to give my life. When a'lan is made and a proclamation is told to fulfill our responsibility, then we are saying labbaik, Ya Allah, on every command I am ready to fulfill your awamir. So once Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, sahaba had vases with different conveyances. So Nabi alayhi salam's camel was amongst the fastest of camels. Nabi alayhi salam himself was a warrior. فَجَاءَ رَبِيٌ بِنَاقَةٍ لَهُ فَسَبَقَهَا. So a Bedouin came and his camel challenged the camel of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it turned out such that Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's camel lost the race. فَشَقَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمِينَ. So Sahaba was stressed and perplexed that this does not look good in the sense that when you love somebody you don't want them to lose. So Nabi alayhi salam said, إِنَّهُ حَقٌ. This is the truth of dunya. أَلَّا يَرْفَعَ شَيْئًا مِنْ أَمْرِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا وَضَعَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept the system of the dunya like that. Sometimes you're on a high, sometimes you're on a low, sometimes you're on progress, sometimes you're on retrogression. إِلَّا وَضَعَهُ. Sometimes it's at its peak and then it becomes disgraced and humiliated. So that's the dunya. So probably a person has something which is valuable today, tomorrow it's valueless. They know somebody that's very obedient and loyal, overnight they become disloyal and they betray. How many good employees out there they were, and suddenly overnight they cleaned out a safe, they gone across the border. They worked for 20, 30 years, set them up, set their family up, gave them all their needs and necessities. Overnight they became disloyal. Likewise, employees you looked after, gave them a good salary, they go and open up another business exactly like yours, take all your suppliers, utilize your entire business plan and cause much harm to you. No matter how much good you did to them, they do not realize it and appreciate it. So that's the nature of the dunya. Somebody, a husband betrays a wife, wife betrays a husband, children betray their parents. It's on all avenues, on a mega level, and a global scale. Somebody writes a message to his wife, I love you, and he puts an alphabet there, and she says, but that's not me. That's not me. So he says, no, I wrote you, I love you, D means darling. He tries to find an excuse. He writes or tells her, I can never forget the most special moment in our life when we were at this place here. She says, what place are you talking about? We were never there. We were never there. You forgot it was secret second wife. Or a lot of youngsters nowadays have 3-4 people they're going out with at the same time. Eventually they lose track. So dunya is like that. No matter how much poetry and wild songs and poems they might write to you, وَحُسِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. The reality of dunya is, it's always deceiving. One woman went for her husband for a routine checkup. They did tests. The doctor, after several tests, evaluated the patient and then called the wife aside alone. So he told the wife, I'm afraid I have very bad news for you. Your husband is going to die. There's only one option we have is, I can give you a very strict and stringent routine for you to follow. And if you follow that, then slowly this illness will dissipate. She said, what do I need to do? He said, every morning, you first need to give him a good, healthy breakfast. And lunch and supper, it needs to be very nutritional as well. You should not burden him with any household chores whatsoever. And it is important and imperative that the house be kept spotless. You should not burden him with any chores of the house. Make sure the house is germ-free. Don't give him any responsibility of the children. And last but not least, you should not give him any stress. Then the doctor tried to console him and said, you know, it is a great responsibility on your shoulders. But this is the only way we can keep your husband alive. So on the way home, the husband inquired from the wife, what did the doctor say? She said, he said, there's very bad news, you're going to die. It's very bad news, you're going to die. She didn't mention anything else. So dunya is full of betrayal. Allegiance is very rare. They say, Isa alayhi salam, you say, man dha alladhi yabni ala mawj al-bahr daran. How foolish, how is it possible that a person builds their residence on a wave? تِلْكُمُ الدُّنْيَا فَلَا تَتَّخِذُوهَا قَرَارًا. That is the actual reality of dunya. Don't make that your eternal abode. First on water unstable, then on a wave even more unstable, and believe something solid on a wave that is foolishness. Thus said to him, عَلِّمْنَا عَمَلًا وَاحِدًا يُحِبُّنَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Teach us one action that we'll get close to Allah. قَالَ أَبْغِضِ الدُّنْيَا. Hate dunya means whatever you have needs for dunya, fulfill that. But don't have your heart inclined to dunya. يحبكم الله. Allah will love you. Allah will love you. So this attachment of the world is about the heart. So somebody can be driving in a 1940 old conveyance vehicle, Beetle, and there's a clanking sound and the paint is all rusted, but he's driving with pride and arrogance. I got an old classic vehicle. Then he's hated and despised in the eyes of Allah. Somebody else may be in a Ferrari, but they are humble and they attribute in this is a ni'mat of Allah, and they don't have pride. So on every meter, they're getting close to Allah, and the other person, every meter is going far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So dunya is such, we shouldn't get trapped internally. Our hearts internally should be 100% for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, whatever planning, whatever efforts a person is doing goes in vain. Person will do a lot of efforts and thinks so he got it under control, but it is all in vain. They said there was one small puny bus driver and he pulled up at the bus stop and one giant man climbed on the bus. So as he climbed in, he said, Big John doesn't pay, with a very gruff voice, and he marched straight to the seat. So obviously bus driver was small puny and he was muscular and a giant of a man. So the driver didn't say anything. The next day, same thing happened. The man mounted the bus. He looked at the bus driver and said, Big John doesn't pay. And then he went to his seat. So this continued for several days, which perturbed the driver. And he didn't like his attitude. So he decided, I'm going to go to gym. He applied. He got into the gym membership. He got a personal trainer and he started doing weights. And it took him 3-4 months, whatever he needed to do, he did it. Now, after that intensive bodybuilding course, the day came where he was waiting for Big John. So as he stopped at the normal stop with his rippling muscles, which was once upon a time a piece of skin of bone, and Big John entered and he announced, Big John doesn't pay. So the bus driver caught up and he went to Big John and he said, oh yes, and why doesn't Big John pay? So he tried to show his macho and his manliness. So Big John reached for his pocket. So as he was reaching for his pocket, now the driver didn't know what. Is he going to pull out something? Is he going to take out a knife? And he put it in his pocket and he pulled out the bus pass. Big John pulled out the bus pass. So a person makes effort and they think so, okay, we got the situation under control. But in actual reality, they don't have anything under control. So we shouldn't fall trapped to this dhoka and deception of dunya. Sayyidina Nabi alayhi salam warned Sahaba, لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ مَا أَعْلَمُوا لَضَحِكْتُمْ قَلِيلًا وَلَبَكَيْتُمْ كَثِيرًا. Oh my beloved Sahaba, if you knew what I knew, you would have laughed less and cried more. وَلَهَانَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الدُّنْيَا. And you would have realized how disgraceful and degraded and valueless dunya is. وَلَآثَرْتُمْ الْآخِرَةِ. And you would have given all your time, all your energy, all your resources towards akhirah, to balin jannah. وَمَا تَلَذَّثْتُمْ بِالنِّسَاعِ الْفُرُشِ. You would have not had time to spend with your wives and take benefit. You wouldn't even been talking to your wives and children. وَلَا خَرَجْتُمْ إِلَى السَّعَدَاتِ. You would have ran to the jungles seeking refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not knowing whether you will be saved or destroyed. Another riwayat, مَا أَكَلْتُمْ طَعَامًا عَلَى شَهْوَةٍ أَبَدًا. Even if you had to eat food, you would have not taken any pleasure out of any morsel of food that you ate. You would have not gotten any pleasure out of it. وَلَا شَرِبْتُمْ شَرَابًا عَلَى شَهْوَةٍ أَبَدًا. And you would have not drank anything and got any pleasure and enjoyment out of it. And you would have run into the jungles, beating yourselves and crying profusely. If you just had an atom's amount of knowledge, what knowledge I have of Akhirat. So one should not be deceived by the outward appearance. Sometimes a person feels, externally I will go by that, but that is a big deception. They say there was two gas company servicemen, one was young, one was old. They went into a neighborhood, they checked the meters, and on the final round they decided that they're going to test each other's fitness. So the older man challenged the youngster to the race. As they ran to the truck, they were surprised and they seen a woman who was huffing and puffing and running after them as well. So they turned around and asked her, "Oh ma'am, what's wrong with you? Is there a problem?" So she was out of breath and she gasped. She said, "When I saw two gas men running as hard as the two of you, I figured out the best thing to do is to run. So outwardly, the external is one thing, but in reality, it's something else. Where we should be panicking for Akhirat, we're not panicking. And where we shouldn't be panicking for dunya and the things of the dunya, that is giving us panic, worry, concern. So the solution we are seeking is something else. A man went into a drugstore and he asked the pharmacist if he could give him something for hiccups. So without any warning, without anything, the pharmacist gave him a smack on his face. So as that happened, he got very upset and he said, "What are you doing that for?" So the man replied with a smile. He said, "I bet you don't have hiccups anymore. So the man said, "I don't have hiccups. My wife is the one that has it. I don't have hiccups." So sometimes we think so, we're solving a problem, but we're actually very far from the reality of solving the problem. One researcher was doing research and he wanted to see that whether women dominated men or men dominated women, and he did research to see. So all the people that he interviewed, he got them on one side and said, "Make two lines. Men who were dominated by women should stand on one line and the other on the other line." So there were two lines, the list and the line of men who were dominated women, who were dominated by women, stretched as far as he could see. And in the line where men were dominated women, there was just one person. So he became upset because his research and his data was to teach men and to prepare men to be dominant. And this was the contrary. So he was upset, so he started shouting all the men and saying that, "Why are you in this line? At least you should know something about it." Then he said, "Look at that one person." And he said, "Address all of them and tell them the secret recipe. So he said, "No, I needed to consult my wife in this situation, and she told me, stand in this line. My wife told me to stand in this line, that's why I'm here. I'm following her instructions." So dunya is a deception, how it is, it's a dhoka. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that. The amal for today is, مَنْ قَرَأَ آيَةَ الْقُرْسِ دُبَرَ كُلِّ صَلَاةٍ. Whoever is ayatul kursi after every salah, لَمْ يَمْنَعْهُ مِنْ دُخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَمُوتُ. Nothing will stop him from Jannah until he dies. Means this is a very mujarrab amal. Some riwayat add, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. كان في ذمة الله إلى الصلاة الأخرى. Another rewrite. And Allah's protection is with you till the next salah. May Allah give us tawfiq of making amal wa akhiru da'wana. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.